pessoal. Good afternoon, everybody. Are you listening to me? It's okay. Well, I'll start here. I'm reading the short bio here from our next speaker. I'm very glad of sharing this session with the talk of my friend, Professor Fernando Pereira, a Portuguese researcher with great connections with Brazil and with a huge contributions on our field. The talk title is Towards Visual Immersion Light Fields or Point Clouds. And now, Fernando Pereira is currently with the Department of Electrical and Computer Engineering of Instituto Superior Técnico and with Instituto de Telecomunicações, Lisbon, Portugal. He's an area editor of the Signal Processing Image Communication Journal and associate editor of the EuroZip Journal on Image and Video Processing. And is or has been member of the editorial board of the Signal Processing Magazine, associate editor of the IEEE Transactions on Off Circuits and Systems for Video Technologies, IEEE Transactions on Image Processing, IEEE Transactions on Multimedia, and IEEE Signal Processing Magazine. In 2013 to 2015, he was the editor-in-chief of the IEEE Journal of Selected Topics in Signal Processing. He is or has been a member of the IEEE Signal Processing Society Technical Committees on Image, Video, and Multidimensional Signal Processing, Multimedia Signal Processing, and of the IEEE Circuits and Systems Society Technical Committees on Visual Signal Processing and Communications, and the Multimedia System and Applications. He was an IEEE Distinguished Lecturer in 2005 and elected as an IEEE Fellow in 2008 for contributions to object-based digital visual representation technologies and the standards. He has been elected to serve on the Signal Processing Society Board of Governors in capacity of member at large for 2012 and to 2014-2016 terms. Since January 2018, he is the SPS Vice President for Conference. UFA. Since 2013, he is also an EuroZip Fellow for contributions to digital video representation technologies and standards. He has been elected to serve on European Signal Processing Society Board of Directors for 2015 to 2018 term. Since 2015, he is also an IET Fellow. He has been the MPEG requirements chair from 2002 to 2007, and since February 2006, he is the JPEG requirements chair. He has been a member of scientific and program committees of many international conferences and workshops. He has been general chair of the Picture Coding Symposium in 2007, the technical program chair of the International Conference on Image Processing in 2010, in 2016, the technical program chair of the International Workshop on Image Analysis for Multimedia Interactive Service in 2008 and 2012, and the general chair of the International Conference on Quality of Multimedia Experience in 2006. He has been participating in the impact standardization activities, notably as the head of the Portuguese delegation, chairman of the impact requirements groups, and chairman of the of many other ad hoc groups related to the Impact 4 and the Impact 7 standard. He's a co-editor of the Impact 4 book and the Impact 21 book, which are reference books in their areas. He won the first Portuguese IBM Scientific Award in 1990 and the ISO Award for Outstanding Technical Contribution for his contributions to the Impact Visual Standard in 1998. And an honorable mention of the UTL Santander Tota Award for Electrical Engineering in 2009, 2010, 2011, and 2012. He won the Excellent Professor Award from the Electrical and Computers Engineering Department of Instituto Superior Técnico in 2010 and 2011 and 2012. He has contributed more than 250 papers in international journals, conferences, and workshops, and made several tens of invited talks and conference and workshops. His areas of interest are video analysis, coding, descriptions, and adaptation, and advanced multimedia service. This is the impressive short bio of Professor Fernando, and we almost finished the time for the talk, only reading the short bio. Fernando, thank you very much to accept our invitation. Please, you can share your screen and start your talk. Thank you very much.
Well, thank you very much. You almost using all my time. let me first thank you for the invitation. It's always a pleasure to be somehow in connection with my friends in Brazil. I will now share my screen. So we all know, these are difficult days. I hope you are all and families, I hope you are safe. So the topic of today, as you can see here for me, is about light field immersion, so visual immersion. And there is this big question about should we go light fields or point clouds? Anyway, before I start, I have here a slide where you can see a little bit of my bio. You know, it's a bit strange after everything that Luciano said, but I just want to stress that because I am the vice president of the Signal Processing Society for conferences, I was asked to tell you a little bit about the Signal Processing Society, okay? So the Signal Processing Society is one of the biggest, in fact, is the fourth largest society of IEEE. It was the first society, and it was established in 1948. It is a big society also geographically. It goes in 120 countries. And it's expanding in terms of chapter and student branches. And of course, we have many journals and conferences, a lot of very exciting activities, as you can imagine. Of course, there are many things for students. There are many student activities and resources. There are competitions. There are job opportunities. There are conference discounts. So if you want to go to conferences when we will go again physical, there are conference discounts, a lot of travel grants. If you are a student, you can ask for a travel grant and you don't have to pay the trip. And of course, as you know, ICIP for visual people, ICIP is a very big event and it is coming next week and it will be for free. So if you are not an author, you can register for free and you know, you can have a lot of fun during the next week. Of course, if you are also interested in participating in the activities as a volunteer, there are many activities where you can participate. Of course, they are related to the conferences, to the journals, to the awards, you know, there are a lot of things. So just contact people either in Brazil or at the society or even myself, and you can find your place in the Signal Processing Society. That it's very much welcoming everybody, especially students. And as you can see here, the SPS Society is the $1 society. So the membership of our society is just $1. If you register now, you will get 2021. You will get the rest of 2020 and all 2021. So you are very welcome. It's a very nice society, a lot of nice people, a lot of exciting topics. So join our society and I'm sure you will enjoy. Okay, after this introduction to the Signal Processing Society, so let's go to the topic of my talk, okay? So this is about visual immersion, a very exciting topic in these days, a lot of people working in visual immersion. And you know, I will basically debate a little bit between the light fields and the point clouds. I will try to compare a little bit. I will try to give you some of the advances, especially in coding. And you know, in order you can yourself understand better what are the big issues between light fields and point clouds. You know, of course, it's about visual immersion. So, you know, visual immersion has a very important benchmark, reality. This is our benchmark. When you deal with technology for visual immersion, this is what you want to get, okay? We want to get an immersion like in reality, okay? So, of course, visual immersion is about light, okay? We have to deal with light. And of course, in the reality, light is basically all around us. And that's why we have such perfect and intense immersion in reality. And in fact, our dream experience, when we develop technology for visual immersion, our dream experience is the same. This is our dream. This is our benchmark. We want to offer people experiences that are as immersive and realistic and intense as reality. So in fact, of course, we have this idea of full immersion. Of course, along the years, the technology has been evolving towards this dream, the dream of having immersive experiences close to reality. But as you know, we still have a long path, and light fields and point clouds play a very important role in this adventure towards full immersion, as transparent as the reality. Of course, sometimes it's important to assess immersion. So how can we assess immersion? So one way, and a quite easy way to have an idea about how much immersion you have in your system is the famous degrees of freedom. And they come from reality again, from our benchmark. So in reality, we have at least the so-called 6 degrees of freedom. You have 3 rotations, okay? You have 3 translations, okay? Back and forward, left, right, up and down, okay? So in reality, when we have this full immersion in reality, we have these 6 degrees of freedom in terms of our rotations and translations. So if we want to emulate this benchmark, it's normal then when we have a multimedia system where you target visual immersion, it's normal that you assess the system also with these types of degrees of freedom. How much degrees of freedom can we get in a multimedia system? Of course, we started long ago with this type of experience, okay? And here, basically, we have 0 degrees of freedom. If you turn around, okay, if you just rotate your head, you will see something else that it's not part of the multimedia experience, so it breaks your immersion, right? So it's basically the starting point. And although these type of experiences are not so immersive, like this, for example, where you have the at least the rotational degrees of freedom. So that's why these type of experiences and virtual reality, there is an important step forward in the immersion, because at least you can rotate your head, okay? And in terms of rotations, you have now an experience where the content changes fully when you basically exercise the rotations in your displacements. Of course, you don't have the translational degrees of freedom, okay? So if you have these glasses, if you just go to the left or to the right, nothing basically changes. So it's just 3 degrees of freedom, but it's a very important step forward. And of course, the immersion that you get is much more intense than with a television, for example. And of course, as I said, our target is these famous 6 degrees of freedom, okay? The 3 rotational and the 3 translational, and that's what we will be speaking and what we will be targeting when we speak about light fields and point clouds. So you can see here the outline of my talk. So I will speak about some of the basics, a little bit of the past. I will after go to the planoptic function, and from there I will speak about light fields and point clouds, especially the coding part, and I will finally conclude with some message that I hope it will be clear at that point. Okay, so where did we start? Okay, for many, many decades, I told you, we had these frame-based visual systems, okay? They have been around now, many decades, about 80 years, okay? With big developments in the 30s, in the 40s, in the 50s. And of course, as I told you, although this is a kind of 0 degrees of freedom, you just have to point your head to the screen in front of you and not rotate and not translate. Okay, it was very successful. It was very powerful. And as you know, it has changed the world. Of course, even in this type of model, you have systems where the degree of the immersion has been increasing. And it has been increasing basically by increasing the size of the screens and by increasing, of course, the resolution. Because if you just increase the size of the screens without increasing the resolution, the quality may be very poor. But the idea is that by increasing the resolution and the size of the screens, you will feel more your field of view. And of course, you will feel more immersed because you can basically only see in your screen the content from the experience and not other types of content from your living, from your home, if you have a small screen, okay? So still in this frame-based model, there was a lot of racing in terms of immersion that basically was including bigger screens, more resolution, and even the eye dynamic range is part of this game because eye dynamic range basically builds more realistic and so more immersive experiences. Okay, so of course, at some stage, we start seeing multiple views, so multiple perspectives of the same scene. Of course, you can start with stereo. You can have more cameras. And as you know, for some time, you know, for example, in MPEG, there were a few multi-view coding standards where basically you start having the idea that I can exercise at least some horizontal displacements, some horizontal parallax. And this is a small step towards having a little bit of freedom in terms of displacements. Of course, you know, in this process, because if you want to have immersion, you know, we live in a 3D world. And of course, we realize that the 3D immersion is very important. And one of the things that happened at some stage was this idea of having a new type of sensor, not only a sensor for texture, RGB, or luminance and chrominances, but having a sensor for depth. And as you know, when you have depth, you have basically some idea of the position of the objects in the 3D space. So this is a new type of information that can really play a very important role in experiences that should be immersive, realistic, and of course, somehow three-dimensional, okay? So these new types of sensors, of course, have been playing an important role in the type of representation models that can bring the users, you know, eye immersion. And as you can see here, there were a lot of solutions, texture only and texture with depth, where basically we try to give a little bit of parallax, a little bit of rich experiences in terms of multiple views to the scene. And as I told you, you have even a few MPEG standards, some with depth, some without depth, where there was this attempt basically to bring different perspectives to the scene. Of course, as you know, in these standards, you only have horizontal parallax, and most of the times the horizontal parallax was quite limited. So the quality of the experiences that you could provide was clearly limited by the dimension, the amount of parallax, and of course the fact that was only horizontal. Of course, most of you never had experiences with multiple views. We all had experiences with stereo. Probably you went to the cinema to see stereo movies. And as you know, the quality of experience is not really great, you know. After a while, the novelty effect disappears and the immersion is not very, very intense. There is only stereo parallax, okay? Only two views for the two eyes. So not much degrees of freedom. It's very far from the real world, you know, and our benchmark, it's very far. And so it was not really extremely successful, especially if your target, if your benchmark is the reality and all the immersion that the reality can bring you. So it was clear that we had to move to some representation models that were more sophisticated. Of course, in the stereo domain, a lot of people complained about the glasses, right? You know, we didn't like the glasses for the stereo experience. So it was a kind of funny that the next big step was basically glasses again, okay? And of course, I am speaking about these VR or augmented reality glasses, but that, as I told you, can offer you because they really enclose your visual system in this reality, it can give you the possibility to exercise the three rotational degrees of freedom. And this is a big step forward if you compare with stereo
or the normal television. It is really an increased degree of immersion. Of course, we cannot exercise the translational degrees of freedom, but you know, it was clearly a step forward. And you know, there are a lot of developments in this domain where the resolution has been increasing, you know, the quality of the experience has been increasing. Although if you look to it, you know, it's something that you cannot imagine as the final step. It's only the rotational degrees of freedom. You know, you have these glasses, you know, you have sometimes a delay, that photon to motion delay or motion to photon delay. So there are a lot of problems of cyber sickness. And one of the arguments is to say, yeah, this is not that real. This is not so close to the reality. We are missing the capability to be more free also in terms of translating, also in terms of going beyond the rotations. So if this is not the end of it, so if this is not enough, if we cannot imagine people looking to a 3 hours movie with this type of thing, so what is next? We have to take a step forward again, okay? Which is great for research, but you know, we have to maybe rethink the whole problem of a visual representation. We have to go back to the roots and remember that this is all about light. Okay, and in this context, as you can see here, there is something called the planoptic function that plays a very important role. So if you go back to our benchmark, if you go back to reality, where people is surrounded by objects, and of course objects that reflect the light, don't forget that in our visual system, we see the world around us because there is light reflected in the objects. Otherwise, there would be no visual experience. So light is fundamental. So so the objects communicate with us through the light. And so the question is, how can we represent the light in a very powerful and complete way in order that when we are in a multimedia system, we can have the same experience and the same immersion that we have when we go around in the real world and we have the light around us. So the issue is, how can we represent in a full, complete, and powerful way the light environment? And you know, the planoptic function tries to address this problem. So of course, it's a very powerful, it's almost scary function because it tries to be very complete. So as you can see here, it has 7 dimensions. And the dimensions that you can see here are related to the space and position and time and wavelength. And basically the planoptic function, so the value of the planoptic function is basically the value of the light components in any position of the space, the light from any direction at any time instant for any wavelength. So it's a function that can measure the light that has existed for billions of years in the past and for billions of years in the future in all positions in our galaxy or in other galaxies. So, you know, it's huge, okay? It's huge, it's very complete. And in a way it's nice because it's a target. So you cannot reach it easily. So you have research for many years, okay? But it's very powerful and somehow tells you, okay, that's the type of thing that could solve my problem if I can approach it, you know, step by step. Okay, so this is, keep in mind the problem. So the planoptic function really goes deep in my problem because if I could measure the planoptic function, I would have the light in any position coming from any direction. So it's like I could measure the light around me, and if I can replicate this light, I could have an experience that is similar to the real world experience. So the issue is, how can we capture the planoptic function? So the problem starts very much with the sensors, because you know we have to capture, we have to measure the light in the real world in some way with some model, okay, with some sensors that can basically allows me to represent this info, capture this information, represent it, eventually code it, and on the other side, to have some type of display, planoptic display, where I give back the light to the users, and they will feel almost like in the real world. That's my dream, right? So of course, we know that the sensors have been evolving a lot. Well, they have been evolving, of course. Even the video sensors, they have more resolution, they have more frame rate, they have more dynamic range, they have more color gamut. But of course, you have also a lot of new sensors. We have arrays of cameras. We have lens LED cameras with micro arrays of lens. We have 360 cameras. We have depth cameras. We have LiDARs. We have a lot of new tools that should allow us to have more sophisticated representation models, because we can capture more information from the real world. And that's where we should go. We should go to the real world, because the real world is where the experiences are perfect, right? So the challenges here are very much these five that you can see here. So the question is, how can we offer these very intense immersive experiences with the 6 degrees of freedom? I want the 6 degrees of freedom like in reality, and the Planoptic function has the information for these 6 degrees of freedom. What type of data model? Okay, and as you will see, we'll be speaking about light fields in point clouds and meshes, okay? What type of compression? Because as you can imagine, the Planoptic function is so huge in amount of data. So it's normal that if you want a very immersive experience, you will have a lot of data and you will have to compress this data. Otherwise you will not have practical systems. It will be impossible, okay? It will be just something very platonic in a way. What type of rendering, by the way? As you will see, you will have certain types of displays, and sometimes we have to match the representation model and the display with some type of rendering. And of course, what type of experience? Because at the end of the day, is this a good experience for the users? Do they enjoy my 6 degrees of freedom or the flavor that I give them of these 6 degrees of freedom, okay? So these are questions that are very important. And I can imagine that there will be research on these questions, you know, for some time, because they are very difficult and deep questions. And of course, there are some answers already, okay? So probably you heard about light fields and point clouds and meshes and even holography. And we know that there are a lot of developments in these areas in many ways. In the capturing of the information, in the coding of the information, in the rendering, in the displays, you need to address the full pipeline in order you can bring the reality, acquisition, coding, rendering to the user, and the user looks to this display and as much as possible, a transparent experience with the feeling, the immersion, the realism that is on the other side of the pipeline. So we want a pipeline that it is as transparent as possible, okay? Again, this is my dream, and I'm telling you about my dream, and I hope that it's also the dream of many of you. So let's try to see, okay, what are the ways to somehow to fulfill the promises and the features and the power of this Planoptic function. So how can we try to acquire the information associated to the Planoptic function, and how can we code it, and how can we display it? Okay, so as you saw in my title, we have this duality between light fields and point clouds. One of the most popular solutions, it's basically this light field representation that it's very much a pixel-based representation. Okay, so of course the pixels, we know about pixels, okay? We know about 2D images and 2D videos, so we know about pixels. And as you can see here, this is a good example. What you can see is this, we have here a circular array of cameras. And basically when the cameras look to the car, they are basically doing something that it's close to the Planoptic function, because each position in the car, in the object car that is reflecting the light, is being seen from different directions. And so you are measuring the light reflecting from a certain point in the car in multiple directions. So I am somehow acquiring the information of the Planoptic function, okay? So the light fields, which means multiple perspectives, multiple 2D perspectives of the scene. And I want many, because the more I have, the more complete and realistic and immersive will be my representation. But you know, this type of representation, as you can see, is basically based on technology that it's a kind of familiar to us, which is basically 2D views and 2D perspectives of the scene, as many as possible. And you can have a circular array, you can have a linear array, can be bidimensional. This is unidimensional, okay? But you can have, of course, disparity and parallax in the vertical direction. You know, in the context of light fields, we cannot hide that there was an important development at some stage. As you know, the LiTOR cameras have been discontinued. But, you know, there was a company that developed one type of camera. And the beauty of this is that you can see here, this light field acquisition system is quite cumbersome. You have many cameras. So this is physically heavy and complex. The beauty of this light field acquisition is that you have a single camera. And as you can see in this single camera, you have here basically an array of microlens that receives the information from the scene to the objective lens. And as you can see with this microlens array, we can measure information here at the sensor that corresponds to different directions associated to the same point. So these basically, these microlens, they play a role of very small lens, okay? So it's a little bit like this guy, but now at a different dimension where the cameras are like these microlens. Of course, you know, the fact that you have everything in a single camera, of course, it means that you cannot have a lot of parallax, both horizontal and vertical. But it's a kind of small disparity light field that somehow can bring a little bit of the features that a big light field can give you at a different dimension. So this type of thing, as you can imagine, gives this type of light fields. So this is a lens-less light field. You can see here these small, kind of small squares, the so-called microimages. And these microimages that correspond to one of the microlens, they basically give you the information coming from the scene in a different direction. Okay, so if you amplify, this is what you get. So this type of micro a light field, a lens-less light field, it's not something that you can put directly in a 2D display. So you have to go to this light field with a lot of information. All these microlens get information from different directions, and you have to basically render this light field to the direction, to the viewing direction that you want to give to the user. And when you do it, you get a usual 2D image, okay? Of course, when you have this type of light field, so now I'm going back to an array of cameras, okay? So as you can see here, I have two-dimensional parallax. I have views that change on the horizontal and on the vertical. And as you can see here, again, the same thing happens. I'm still addressing the planoptic function, right? Because for example, this point in my scene is being seen by these different cameras, and it is going to these different perspectives in a different direction. So when you do this type of thing, the light field really goes again in the planoptic function direction. I am acquiring for this point and for other points, the light in different directions in the same way that the planoptic function represents the light for each point in different directions. Of course, depending on the size of the ray, you will have more or less horizontal and vertical parallax, but basically what you get is this type of thing. And of course, we want to have a light field with as many views as possible in order I have a larger field of view, but this is the type of field, the type of light field that we can get. It's basically many views, ideally with high resolution. And as you can imagine, and as I told you, this is quite heavy from the data point of view, not to speaking from the acquisition point of view, but also from the data point of view. Because if each of these images is HD or even 4K, you have a huge amount of information. Of course, you know, we have to deal with it. Of course, when you render the light field to a 2D display, either you pick one of these views, or you can even try to synthesize views between the really acquired views, okay? So, but basically, again, you have the rendering problem, because when you put your light field in a regular 2D display, you have to bring the best of the light field to the point of view that you want to give to the user in a very immersive way. Of course, at some stage, I told you there were these depth sensors, and the depth sensors have a new type of information. They are not anymore just more views. They give a new type of data. They give information about the depth in my scene. Okay, so you could imagine that you have pairs. You can have pairs of texture and depth data for each point of view. And of course, in this way, you have a much more powerful representation in the scene. And I can do a lot of things with this depth. And in fact, the fact that I have the depth even can relax my requirements in terms of the number of points of view that I am capturing. It can simplify my acquisition because the fact that I have texture together with depth allows me to more easily render, synthesize views in the middle. So these views here that you can see here, they are not acquired, but they are simply synthesized from the neighboring views especially if I have depth. So the fact that I have depth somehow complements my texture, and the pair depth together with the texture becomes more powerful in a way that the density of my light field may be reduced because I have now, for each real acquisition point, this powerful pair of texture and depth. So this is really important. So this was the light field point of view, very much the pixels and after the pixels plus depth. A very powerful combination. But of course, as you can see, we are speaking about 2D maps. 2D maps of texture, 2D maps of depth, and 2D maps is something that we know very well. We have been dealing with 2D maps for decades, so we know very well about 2D maps. What is an alternative? And as I told you, a very popular alternatives in these days. So against the pixels, let's have the voxels, okay? So as you can imagine, the voxels are 3D elements. And as you can see in this slide, basically a point cloud that in this presentation is the counterpart of the light field. Well, the point cloud is basically a set of points in the 3D space that start by having a position, X, Y, Z position. So basically, again, is so close to the planoptic function. The planoptic function also starts by having a position after you have an angle, a wavelength, and time, and you measure the light. So a point cloud is basically points in the 3D space. Of course, these points are on the surface of the objects to define the objects for my visual experience, okay? And of course, to these points, you can allocate attributes. And of course, these attributes, the most important one is color. And you can have a single color for each point, or like the planoptic function, you can have a color that it's different depending on the angle that I look to the point. And of course, this is a richer representation, and it will allow me to have more realistic and immersive experiences. Very heavy from the data point of view. We don't have a lot of test material in these days where the color changes with the direction. There is some, by the way, in MPEG there is some. But you know, of course, that what would be a more close representation of the planoptic function. Okay, these point clouds can be acquired in many ways. And also because point clouds and light fields, they are brothers, they represent the same reality with a different model. Of course, you can even go from one to the other. You have many light fields, many point clouds in these days that have been acquired as light fields, and you extract the point clouds from the light fields because, you know, it's basically representing the same type of information. They have different properties, they have different weaknesses, they have different strengths, but you know, you in theory, you could go from one to the other because they represent the same reality. Of course, they have different weaknesses and strengths, and they may be more interesting for one or another application, depending on the characteristics of the application, okay? So, but basically, as I said, a point cloud is basically a representation of the reality where you have these voxels, and of course, these voxels can be empty or filled in the 3D space, and that when they are filled, they have attributes, and the most common is the color or the multiple colors of a voxel. And of course, you can have point clouds of basically everything. Of course, these point clouds can have more or less density, okay, more or less precision also, okay? But you know, the idea here is that I have a more geometric representation because I didn't go like in the light fields to 2D maps. I still have a 3D structure, my X, Y, Z set of points. Okay, this slide is an old slide from a friend of mine, Gauthier Lafruy, which, by the way, I think is attending. You know, and this slide basically tells you what I was saying. You know, point clouds and light fields, they are the two sides of the same coin. Because, you know, if you have an object in the 3D world, okay, in the point clouds, you basically represent the points over the object. And of course, if you have to render on a screen, okay, you have to render, you go from the scene geometry, you go from the 3D points, and you basically get a 2D perspective of this three-dimensional representation. But of course, you can also do the opposite. Maybe in the reality, you had the object, you acquired some views of the object, like in a light field, and later, if you want, you can reconstruct the 3D structure, like a point cloud, from the light fields. So in practice, when you have the real world, you can represent this real world as a set of 3D points, the point cloud model, or you can go back to views, the light fields, but the light field will also allow you to come back to the object and reconstruct the 3D geometry. So as I said, they are twin brothers, and you can do a lot of things between them, even going back and forward. If you look to them and you try to understand what are the strengths and weaknesses, well, we can try to do a little bit. Well, both can be 6DOF. Both can give you this type of representation models. They can give you experiences where you can exercise the 6 degrees of freedom. The light fields, if you have horizontal and vertical parallax, you can translate, okay? And the point clouds, where in theory, you can go around them, you can approach, become closer, far away. So they can be very powerful in terms of 6 degrees of freedom. Of course, one is a very much an image-based representation, as I said, the pixel-based representation. The other is more geometry-based, and you have the voxels. Both are very heavy from the data point of view. You see, here I speak about tens or hundreds of cameras. So if you want to have enough parallax, okay, if you want to have enough capacity to move around, and if you want enough density in the light field, and if you want enough resolution in each view, well, it's very heavy. On the same way, if you want to have a realistic experience with point clouds, you need point clouds with a good density, with enough points for the details to be represented. So this is both have the same feature here, because they both represent the same type of information, and it's a lot of information if you want to have these immersive experiences. But of course, there are some differences. In theory, you know, the objects in the point clouds, they are more easy defined. It's easier to interact with an object in the point cloud domain, because a set of points may correspond to an object, and it's easier to play with it, go around it. In the light fields, the object is projected in the different views, so the interaction with an object may be more difficult. And of course, for the light fields, as it says here, reusing the technology that we have from 2D images and 2D video, it's natural. While in the point clouds, these look not so natural, although as you will see later, we have now point cloud coding solutions that also use or reuse, if you want, the 2D technology that we have already very advanced for video coding, for example. Okay, so there are differences and similarities. And as I said, I am not claiming that one is better than the other. They may be even combined. You can have a scene where the background is a light field and you have objects as a point cloud. It depends on your needs. It depends on your requirements. So let me now try to tell you. So we have point clouds, light fields, pixel-based, voxel-based, okay? So what is going on in terms of standardization? Okay, in terms of standardization, you have both JPEG and MPEG. MPEG now, I will keep saying MPEG, although MPEG is a bunch of working groups. You have the JPEG Plano standard in JPEG. And you know, this JPEG Plano standard, it's really a top-down approach, and it is thought as a set of tools that basically allow you to deal with the different type of models that you can have when representing planoptic imaging, planoptic data. As you can see here, in JPEG Plano, I usually say that there are three main legs, because JPEG Plano looks to the Plano from planoptic, looks to the planoptic function representation in three different ways. The light fields, the point clouds that I already told you, and the holographic representation. I will not go too much in the holographic representation. It's clearly less developed nowadays, okay? Light fields and point clouds are more advanced. And for that reason, they are closer to the market, or they are already in the market. And that's why I will dedicate more attention to light fields and point clouds. But JPEG Plano tries to acknowledge that there are many ways, many models to represent the same information that as a kind of a limit is represented by the Plano optic function. Okay, what is going on in JPEG Plano? Well, JPEG Plano has multiple parts, as you can see. You can see the pipeline from the acquisition or the generation of the data to the display. And of course, as you can see, the most important components are coding and packaging. And for coding, you need codecs, and for packaging, you need a file format. So it's normal that you have a first part that it's basically a framework and defines basically a file format for JPEG Plano data. And what is the JPEG Plano data? Well, it can be a light field, can be a point cloud, can be an holography, or can be the same representation of the same object. In a JPEG Plano file, you can have for a certain object the light field representation, the corresponding point cloud representation, and even the holographic representation. And you can use whichever you want, depending on the conditions and depending on the needs, depending on the type of display that you have available. But the idea, as I said, is that you have this framework that not only acknowledges different models, not only as codecs for different representation models, but also as the format, the file format at the systems layer that can put these things together in a scene. And by the way, as I said, you can have a scene where one object is a light field or a part is a light field, and you can have three objects that are different point clouds. So you can have this composition of a visual experience where part of it is light field and part of it is point cloud. What is going on in JPEG Plano in terms of coding? Well, as I will show you, a lot of things have been done in light fields. Somehow it's a kind of normal, you can say, because light fields are pixel-based, okay? And we were kind of more familiar with pixel-based representation. And as you can see here, there are two modes in light fields in JPEG Plano. One based on a 4D DCT transform, and another one that it's more based on predictions and synthesis. I will tell you. So this part is basically done, okay? The JPEG Plano already has finalized standard solutions for light field coding, both lenslet, okay, small disparities, and arrays of cameras, larger disparities. Point clouds, what is going on? Well, as you can see here, JPEG just launched the call for evidence for point cloud coding, very much concentrated on two important requirements, scalability and random access. This call has been launched recently, July this year. And as you will see, there is the call is just closing, the pre-registration closed last week, and the proposal should come in December. Holography also, there is a call for proposal coming in April 2021. So as you can see, the three legs of JPEG Plano, they are not going at the same speed, okay, for multiple reasons, okay. Light fields is more advanced, point clouds it's after, and also holography it's after, although as you can see, the call for proposals in holography is a call for proposals and not a call for evidence. So somehow holography is in front of point cloud coding. So this is the timeline for point cloud coding in JPEG. As I said, the deadline for pre-registration was last week. You will have a deadline for submissions in the 1st of December. And in January at the JPEG meeting, we will analyze the proposals that will arrive for point cloud coding in JPEG. So what is happening on the other main standardization body? I mean, what is going on in MPEG? Okay, MPEG, MPEG as a standard that is a big umbrella of standards, MPEG-I. Of course, in this MPEG-I, there are a lot of technologies that are related to immersion. MPEG-I is about immersion. The I is from immersion. And as you can see here, there are two main ways of dealing with 6 degrees of freedom experiences. One is basically a kind of light field based, and the other is point cloud based, okay? And as you can see here on the top, the point cloud coding, I will tell you a little bit about point cloud coding, but this multi-view plus depth, so texture plus depth, many perspectives of texture plus depth, eventually with two-dimensional parallax, well, I will not tell you much. I know that my friend Gauthier will tell you a lot of things about MPEG-I tomorrow. You can just see here that there are these two parts. One is more related to light fields and 2D perspectives, 2D maps, and the other is more related to point clouds and basically voxels and a more geometrical representation. So I will not go on details of MPEG-I. You will have a presentation on MPEG-I tomorrow, I guess, especially the path that is related to light fields. Okay, so this is the frameworks that exist about planoptic imaging. JPEG Plano in JPEG, MPEG-I in MPEG. What about the specifics of the solutions? So I told you that in JPEG Plano, the component of the light field coding, it's basically done, okay? So what did they do? You know, Professor Carla Pagliari today already told you in detail a lot of things, so I will not go into many details. But, you know, as I told you, when you think about light fields, there are at least two types. You know, the lenslet one, very small disparities. You have a single camera with a micro lens, and you have the rays of cameras where the disparity is larger. And of course, the disparity, the amount of disparity is very important in the coding process because it conditions, of course, the encoding process. So in JPEG Plano light fields, we have basically two modes. One mode is what you can see here called 4D prediction mode. So it's basically about views. You have views, so we are coding light fields. It's basically about views, and we make predictions and synthesis between views using depth to basically code the full light field. The other one is basically 4D transform. So let me tell you a little bit about the 4D prediction mode. So what do you have? So you have here a light field where for each position, you have texture and depth. Okay, so basically you are coding pixels in this case, basically as 2D maps. So you are in the 2D maps and you have depth, okay? So depth is always a difficult decision because if your depth is not good enough, for example, if you extract the depth from the texture sometimes, if you don't have original native depth, the quality of the coding, the performance of the codec is extremely sensitive to the quality of the depth. So it's very important that, you know, if you have a codec where depth plays an important role, the quality of the depth is always an issue, okay? So what do they do? Well, they code the full light field, and the light field can have tens or hundreds of views. You can have a light field that can be, I don't know, 20 by 100, many views. They basically called a few reference views. The reference views could be, for example, the corners, okay? They code the full, they code these reference views. And basically with some depth information or disparity information, they warp, they synthesize predictions for some other views in the middle, okay? As you can see here, they basically make a prediction for some of the views in the middle. And after for the intermediate views, they make a difference, they code the residue for the views that are predicted. So the reference views are coded, for example, with JPEG 2000. And from the reference views, you interpolate, you synthesize other views. And after you code the residue for these views. And next, these second layer views can be again used to do predictions for more views in the middle. So it's a kind of hierarchical thing where you code, interpolate, residue, and you keep adding layers to the light field and more density to the light field. It's a kind of conventional thing in a way. We have been doing this for a long time. This is a very sophisticated, for example, this warping and the merging of the views. So you have many reference views, you do the warping for many of them and you combine them. This is a sophisticated process, but this is basically what it is. It's basically reference views, warping, merging, prediction, residue again, okay. So what about the other view, the other mode? So the other mode, as you can see, is called a 4D transform mode. So you apply, basically, you have a light field, and the light field is a 4D beast, right? You see here, I have a 2D array of views, and each view has a 2D array of pixels. So it's a three-dimensional structure. So the basic idea of this other mode is that, well, like in old JPEG, I was using the 2D DCT to code 2D blocks. In a 4D light field, I should use the 4D DCT to code 4D blocks. So it's basically the sun JPEG. JPEG Plano 4D transform mode is the sun of the old JPEG now acting on the 4D world. Okay, so there is nothing very new here in terms of the basic blocks. So you pick your light field, which is a 4D structure. You have the 2D views and the 2D pixels. Okay, you have the 2D views and the 2D array. Okay, so you make these 4D blocks that are difficult to imagine, but they are 4D blocks in the 4D world. You apply a 4D DCT. After you quantize, like in old JPEG, you do some clustering of the coefficients in a way that you can apply efficient entropy coding, and you have the bitstream of the light field. So this 4D transform mode is very much a replica in the 4D world of the 2D solution from the old JPEG, okay? It works quite well for small parallaxes, not so well for larger parallaxes as it is today. And in fact, you can see here some of the performance. Of course, here it's difficult to see. You have a lot of solutions here. You have the two modes from JPEG Plano. You have AGVC, for example, and you have MVAGVC, where you have also predictions between the two dimensions in a kind of multi-view way. In order this is clear, I'm showing you the BD rates here. Okay, so the BD rates here are regarding an anchor, which is AGVC. Okay, so this is an anchor regarding AGVC, where you basically code AGVC going to the light field and doing this type of thing, a kind of zigzag scanning. Okay, you put the light fields in a pseudo temporal video, okay, in a pseudo video in the temporal dimension, and you code this with AGVC. This is my benchmark. And as you can see, you have many solutions here. This is the transform mode. I have reductions of rate very significant compared with AGVC. You can see here. Well, for different light fields, and this is all lenslet, for different light fields, the reduction is different, but I have very significant reductions. For example, this is the 4D prediction mode. For light fields, lenslet light fields, it's not so good. You see that the 4D transform mode is better for lenslet light fields. But you can see that I have solutions here that are more efficient. For example, this MVAGVC, so AGVC with bidirectional predictions, okay? You can see that the reduction compared with HDVC is even larger. So why did we have a new standard in JPEG Plano if you have here solutions that are here more efficient? And as you know here, there is another component that plays an important role. You know, the world is not only about technology. The tradition in JPEG is that there are no royalties. It's a license-free world. The tradition in MPEG is a bit different. You know that AGVC has heavy licensing. So one of the reasons for these two modes that don't perform, they are not the best. If you put, for example, AGVC on the table, the reason is that JPEG wanted to have solutions that in principle, they are royalty-free. And I say in principle because you cannot have promise 100%, but you know there is a very good probability that these solutions are royalty free, and this is very important for the JPEG ecosystem. As you know, the JPEG standards have been basically royalty free until now, and so the reason to have a good light field coding solution that is not even the best, if you put tools like AGVC, it's because we wanted a royalty-free solution, okay? So it means, for example, that if you go to the 4D prediction mode, if you don't use JPEG 2000 to code the information, the reference views in the residue, if you use AGVC, you can also have a more efficient solution. But you know, with JPEG 2000, you have a royalty-free solution. With AGVC, you don't have a royalty-free solution. So never forget this dimension, because it plays a very important role to understand the dynamics of this environment. It's good technology, but you know, you always have to think about many dimensions. Probably the second important one, or sometimes even the first, it's this royalty-free issue. a very, very important issue. Anyway, so this was about light field coding, okay? I told you a little bit about JPEG planar light field coding. Professor Carla Pagliari, if you want to see the video, told many details that, okay, I didn't have time for it. What about point clouds? You know, point clouds, you know, I said the twin brother of light fields. And of course, you can see here the point cloud here in a video. Okay, I just have the rendering of a point cloud in a video. And here I have the point cloud in the 3D space. And of course, I can rotate and go around. And this is what I want. I want this capacity to navigate the 3D world. If you go in the raw domain, the rates are huge. We are speaking about giga bits per second. And so it means that, you know, point clouds, to be good in quality of experience, you need to compress. You know, there is nothing we can do because you need a lot of points, and these points are basically heavy in data. So there are a lot of applications that like point clouds, a lot of them. Okay, and I have here a couple of examples just for you to see what type of applications we can have. So for example, here, I have a situation, an application that it's related to sports broadcasting. Okay, and in this case, you can have the background. The background can even be a light field, and you have the players that can be point clouds. And you know, in this case, you see, I can just navigate around, and you know, I really get a lot of immersion by doing this type of thing, and a lot of flexibility in the way I consume my scene. Here, there is another example related to, again, sports, but it's football on a tabletop. As you can see with these glasses, you have a tabletop, and the guy will see the player playing on the field, and the players can be point cloud objects that basically they evolve in a way that, you know, after the field, that can be, for example, a light field, you have basically these point cloud objects. There are other applications like autonomous vehicles that are also like this type of thing. You know, here you have a point cloud that is basically mapping the environment as a point cloud in order an autonomous vehicle can just go around. So this type of thing is very, very powerful and very important for an emerging domain, which is autonomous vehicles and autonomous driving. Very, very useful type of point cloud. So I hope I showed you that this is really interesting. It's very powerful, it's very flexible, it can be very interactive. So how should we code point clouds? You know, there are many ways of doing it. And you can see here an example of a taxonomy to code point clouds. So of course you have the dynamics of a point cloud. You can have a static point cloud, which is just a moment in time, point cloud that is static. And you can have a dynamic point cloud, okay, with time, a point cloud evolving in time. We can also have a progressive point cloud, which is more a static point cloud that grows to occupy more space, not an evolution in time, but more an extension in space from an initial point cloud that it's static, you know, like for example, in the autonomous driving. Of course, you can code different components of the point cloud. You can code the geometry, the positions, very important. You can code color, the color for the points. Or you can code other attributes, like the normals, the reflectance, something. You can code point clouds lossless or lossy. Depending on the applications, you may need lossless or lossy coding, okay? You know, most of the times probably will be lossy, but some applications may need lossless coding. Imagine if you have a point cloud of my heart. So for medical applications, you can have something like that. So in terms of coding, very, very important is the data structure. What type of data structure am I using to code my point cloud? So a point cloud is a set of points, but you have these points and you may basically cluster them, organize them in many different ways. And as you can see here, I can go to the voxels, I can go to curves, I can make blocks of voxels, I can make a tree of voxels, I can make patches, I can make surfaces, I can even make a graph, which is very popular in these days. So there are many ways of dealing with point clouds when it comes to coding. And of course, if you want to code, well, you have to exploit the redundancy. You have to make predictions. And of course, the predictions can be in space, in time, or in space and time, especially if you have a dynamic point cloud. And finally, probably you may use a transform, and that transform may be block-based or maybe graph-based. And for example, in block-based, you can have a deep learning, a learn transform, which is a very exciting type of thinking in these days. So as you can see here, this is where my voxels are organized in a tree. My voxels are organized in a curve. My voxels are organized in a patch and projected into a 2D map. Or my voxels are organized in a graph where the neighbors of each point basically determine the connections in the graph. So there are many ways of doing it. You will find many solutions in the literature. If you think about static point cloud coding, you know, in static point cloud coding, you have probably the most popular solution is the octree solution. So the point cloud is in a bounding box, and you start dividing the bounding box in the three directions. So you get 8 octants, and you keep doing it. And of course, you keep doing it with the octant is filled. So if the octant is filled, you still divide. If the octant is empty, you don't divide anymore. So you can see here an example where you divide the octants that are filled and you don't divide those. So if the octant is filled, you say 1, and I divide again in 8 octants, and these are filled, I divide again, and those that are not filled, I don't divide. And basically this stream represents my octree to the depth, to the precision that I want. A very simple type of coding, very much very geometric. You basically divide the 3D space in smaller and smaller voxels until reaching the precision that you want. Another type of solution is related to patches. The idea is that you basically make patches of 3D voxels and you project them somehow in a 2D map. So the patch-based approach typically converts the 2D, the 3D problem into a 2D coding problem, because you have clusters of voxels that we call the patch that are projected on a 2D map. And so in this 2D map, what you get is the projection of different patches. And these patches may be defined in many different ways. We will see in a couple of minutes that the MPEG is doing it in a certain way. But the idea here is that I bring the 3D coding problem to the 2D coding world by projecting the 3D voxels into a 2D map. And when you do that, you have to code the texture as a 2D map, and you have to code the position as a 2D map. We will see that. Of course, when you go to dynamic point clouds, the problem is much more difficult. You know, dynamic point clouds, you know, point clouds, they don't even have the same number of points when you go from one frame to another, okay? So as you can see here, the point clouds are not like the images or the frames in video. They all have the same number of pixels, and you have co-position pixels, right? It's easy. You know, you can match them easily, okay? And you can do some motion estimation. You know, for point clouds, it's more difficult. Different frames have different number of points in whatever positions, okay? So the temporal correlation in point clouds, it's quite difficult to exploit. One of the early solutions was also octree-based. And octree-based was basically, I would code with an octree the frames, and I would basically compare the bits of the octree representation with a XOR, and when they are the same, I get zeros. And by getting a lot of zeros, you know, I can compress with entropy coding. But of course, if the frames have motion, when you represent the two frames with an octree and you make a XOR, you have a lot of differences while the object is probably the same. This type of coding does not acknowledge motion and motion estimation. So it's very efficient, very inefficient for dynamic point clouds. Another type of approach is a graph-based approach. So in a graph-based approach, you have the points. You have, for example, the nearest neighbors. You create the graph connecting each point to the nearest neighbors. And you can do a lot of nice things. For example, here, there is a solution where you create the graph and you extract features from the graph to characterize the motion in the point cloud. And to each point, there is a motion associated after feature extraction on top of a graph, okay? And of course, when you have the motion, you can create a prediction for the geometry. And if you have a prediction, you can code the residue of the geometry. But here, the residue of the geometry is after motion compensation. So it's much better because, as we know, if there is time, probably there is motion. And if there is motion and you don't acknowledge and make a prediction with the motion, you know, the compression will be very poor. Okay. So this is a very type of solution, graph-based. There is a very interesting paper. If you are interested, I really suggest you. Okay, but what about standards? You know, I told you that in JPEG Plano, there is a call for evidence going on now, but this is something that in MPEG was much faster. As you can see here, there are already now two standards, point cloud coding standards in MPEG. One, basically, as you can see, so-called VPCC, video-based point cloud coding. So it's basically for dynamic point clouds. And one for GPCC, which is basically for static and the progressive point clouds, where G comes from geometry, okay? And as you can see, there are these categories in MPEG, static, dynamic, and progressive. And as you can see, VPCC is for dynamic, category two, and GPCC is for static and dynamic. What is typically the idea? Well, typically when you have a point cloud, you start by coding the geometry. Because if you put attributes on the geometry and you have a lossy coded geometry, well, you should code the geometry, decode it to have the decoder, the lossy decoded geometry to put the attributes on the lossy decoded geometry. Does not make sense to code attributes for a geometry that you don't have at the decoder, okay? So typically you start by coding the geometry. And after you pick the decoded geometry and you code the attributes put on the top of the decoded geometry. For color, we call this recoloring. We pick the color, the original color, and we bring it to the points in the decoded geometry. So first geometry after color. So you have two solutions, as I said, in two standards in MPEG for point cloud coding. The first one is GPCC for static and progressive point clouds, okay? So you can get lossy or lossless coding, and it's basically a combination of two things, a noctree, as I told you, a noctree, and you can go all the way to the lowest precision or to the highest precision with the octree, or you can go with the octree up to a certain point, and after, for the remaining, for the leaf voxels, you can represent the surface inside as a set of triangles. And this is called a tree soup. So only octree, and as you can see here, for category three, it's basically only octree for the progressive point clouds. But for the static point clouds, you have octree, and if you want, you have the remaining part of the precision of the point cloud is called with this tree soup, where you basically estimate the surface with a set of triangles that can go up to 10 triangles. And this is called the tree soup. So it's a geometric approach, basically a tree of octants and triangles for the remaining part of the point cloud. And this is the architecture. I will not go on the details, but as you can see, you know, you have a codec for the geometry, you have codec for the attributes. For example, we have this RAT transform where people in Brazil, from Professor Ricardo Queiroz, they worked a lot, okay? And you have here the decoder. Okay, I will not go on these details. What about VPCC? Well, VPCC, you see, it's a point cloud codec, but it says video. So somehow it's the type of point cloud codec where wants to take benefit from the very powerful 2D video codec that we have nowadays, okay? So what is the idea? So it's a point cloud, solution where basically you project, you can see here, you basically see you have the point cloud, you have a bounding box. The bounding box basically has four surfaces around the top and the bottom, okay? And the basic idea is that you divide your point cloud in patches. And this is done depending on the normals. So you create patches depending on the normals. So patches are points with similar normals. And you project each of these patches in the direction which surface has a normal that it's closer to the normal of the patch. Okay. So in this way, you have parts of the point cloud that are basically projected and you get this type of thing. Okay. So you basically get patches, parts of the point cloud that are projected in the six surfaces in my bounding box. And you do the same for the depth. You know, this basically tells about the position of these texture points. And of course, you know, you have to code these now as 2D maps. So I'm getting a 2D texture map, and I am getting a 2D depth map. And because, you know, coding these as it is not very efficient, they do padding, they fill the black areas. And when you fill the black areas with padding, of course, the compression of these maps becomes more efficient. But because you have to go back to the 3D world, you need to code this occupancy map that will tell you from these 2D maps which are the points that really existed in the 3D world. The others are simply the result of the padding, and they should not come back to the 3D world. So as you can see, the most important message here is that this is very powerful. You can use AGVC, for example, to code these maps. And of course, this is a very efficient way of coding point clouds. You can use any other codec, by the way. You can use AGVC, you can use VVC, you can use MPEG-1, you can even code one by one with JPEG, okay? But you know, this is the idea. You bring the 3D coding problem to the 2D coding world. This is the architecture. And as you can see, you know, it's a complex architecture where you basically have to do the projection, okay? You create the patches, you do the projection, you code the positions, you code the texture, and you code the occupancy maps. In order you can go back from the 2D maps back to the 3D world, to the points that really exist in the 3D world, because we do a lot of padding for these maps to increase the compression efficiency. So as you can see here, this is basically telling you what I told. I'm using 2D video codecs, any. Okay, AGVC, it's very efficient. In MPEG, it's normal that you use AGVC. Well, they will also be using VVC, but keep in mind again, this is royalty fees on the table, okay? The minute you use AGVC and VVC, you have a problem of royalty fees. So when you think about JPEG Plano and point clouds in JPEG Plano, it's very likely that you will get a point cloud solution that does not have royalty fees. You can never promise anything about patents and royalties and licensing, but you know, that's the tradition. JPEG has a tradition of royalty fees, and MPEG has a tradition of royalty burden, although they tried a lot, you know, of having codecs that were not royalty free, but for video, the ecosystem and for dynamic point clouds using, you know, 2D video codecs, this may be a problem. Okay, I still have 12 minutes. I want to bring you, you know, in these days, you cannot speak in a conference or in a summer school without you know, without speaking about something that it's very hot in these days. And something that it's very hot in these days, as you know, is deep learning, right? We all know that it cannot get hotter in these days than deep learning. So deep learning is a very powerful tool, something that I learned, you know, recently, a couple of years or 3 years ago. And as you probably know, it is bringing incredible results for coding also, not only for analysis and recognition and very much analysis tasks from the computer vision world, but it's becoming so interesting for coding. You know, we have today, and we know that JPEG is developing an image codec for based on deep learning called JPEG AI. And you know, we just did subjective testing and it's better than a GVC intra, okay? So it's very powerful. So when we speak about point clouds, well, it makes a lot of sense saying, okay, let's try deep learning coding, okay? So of course, when you, I don't know how much you know about deep learning, you know, but you know, you have a lot of decisions to take, okay? So we have a point cloud. A point cloud is a set of points, an unstructured set of points. So we have to decide how we structure our input data. So in an image, we have blocks. In video, you can have macro blocks. But you know, in point clouds, we have sets of points, okay? So we have to decide the number of layers, the architecture of your deep learning model, deep learning architecture, how many filters, what is the support of the filter, what is the stride, what is the activation function, and after, what is how many parameters you have in your deep learning model. As you know, a deep learning model is like a big filter. You have a lot of weights, a lot of numbers, and of course, in a different structure, you know, there is a lot of things that have to be decided. Of course, you know, there is, as I told you, there are a lot of solutions already for 2D images. And it's kind of normal then when you go from images to point clouds, it's a kind of extension from the 2D world to the 3D world. So it's a kind of normal that you go to the best 2D image codecs, deep learning based image codecs, and you try to extend them to 3Ds, to 3D. And here, as you can see, we can make blocks in the 3D world. And for example, in our case, for our codec, these blocks, they are basically binary blocks, because for these blocks in the point cloud, I just have to say if each position in the block, it's empty or it is filled. So the first thing that we decided is that we would code the point cloud not only as a set of points, but a set of points structured in a 3D block, a binary 3D block, where each position in the block is a zero or is a one, it's empty or it is filled. Of course, we, as you will see, we will use a kind of a type of architecture that we call an autoencoder. It's a convolutional neural network. So you have what we call the latents. The latents is like the coefficients in the transform domain. And of course, this autoencoder will have a learned transform and a learned anti-transform. So a part of analysis and a part of synthesis that it is learned. And when you decode, it's basically a classification problem. When you decode, you have to classify each position in each block as empty or as filled. And this is basically what we get. Of course, we can code. So the basic idea is that you get the point cloud, and you divide it in 3D blocks, okay? The same way that we divide an image in 2D blocks or a video in 2D macro blocks. And of course, you have point clouds where these blocks can be very dense or can be very sparse. This is the queen point cloud, the boom mama boy. And you know, we have to acknowledge that, okay? In point clouds, I can have high density in some blocks and in some point clouds or low density. So if I want to be efficient in compression, I have to acknowledge that because the point clouds may have very different characteristics. So we developed a deep learning based point cloud codec. I put here the chameleon because it's adaptive. So what does it mean? It means that we developed not a single model for my deep learning model, but I have many models depending on a specific parameter. And these models basically learn to adapt to different characteristics of the point cloud. They can be more efficient for more dense or for more sparse point clouds. And of course, at the codec, if you have multiple deep learning models, when I encode block by block, I can test the models I have and see what is the most efficient for me. As you can see here, our performance is much better than GPCC. So let me show you. This looks very complicated, but it's not that complicated. So I have my input block. My point cloud is divided in blocks. I have my decoded block, okay? This part here, you see here, it's basically the autoencoder, the analysis part of the autoencoder, okay? Here I have the output are my latents. My latents is like my coefficients. This is the decoder, okay? So this part are the analysis and the synthesis part of the autoencoder. You have the latents here, and of course, to the latents, I apply entropy coding with this range encoder. What I have here is another deep learning model that gets my coefficients, my latents, and learns the statistics in order I am entropy coding my latents with an entropy coding adaptive model. And because I have an adaptive model, I also have to send some parameters of the entropy coding model to the decoder. So in this case, you have the autoencoder, encoder and decoder. You have the latents, the coefficients that are entropy coding, and you analyze the coefficients to detect the best statistics to give my entropy coding parameters that are adaptive to the latents in each block. So it's a very adaptive process. And this end-to-end thing, as you can see, this is the input, this is the output, the end-to-end thing, when I train the model, because you know I have to train with a lot of data, the end-to-end thing is trained together. So even the fact that I have here some bit rate for the side information, for the parameters of my entropy codec, it is taken into account the overall rate distortion performance of this encoder. So when I train, and here we have a loss function, that it's an RD loss function. So I train, I have the original, I get the decoded, and I want this to be similar. So my distortion is this focal loss, which is basically it measures how much the classification of my voxels as empty or filled ear is different from my original, it weights this focal loss, which is basically the distortion of the point cloud, with the rate, okay? So it's a rate distortion optimization in the training process, already including the parameters of the adaptive entropy coding. I do this with different alpha parameters. So it means when I am coding, I have a couple and I can have entropy code, the DL-based coding models. So I have deep learning models that have been trained with different parameters for the loss function. So I have models that can be good for more dense or for more sparse blocks of the point cloud. So here, I, as you can see, I code my block for all the models. I select the best one and I send this to the decoder. The decoder gets my information about what is the best model and it decodes my point cloud. So it's basically a deep learning based codec with adaptive selection of the model. And I can have two models, three models, four models, depending on the models. So you can see here the results. So what is this? The black curve is basically GPCC. So this is the MPEG standard. And as you can see, for example, here with five models, I have for four and for two, with five models, the orange curve, you can see that our gains regarding GPCC are huge. The RD curve is so much above GPCC, in this case, GPCC 3 sup. If you want to see these charts, it shows you what type of alpha parameter, what type of model it's good depending on the rate I am and depending on the density of the point cloud. This is the number of blocks in each point of the point cloud. So if you have a lot of blocks, a lot of points in a point and a block, a lot of points in the block, very dense blocks, you are here. These are sparse blocks. For the lower rates, typically I choose alpha equal to 0.9. So this is the green model. But if you are in the higher rates, you choose more the blue model. So we have this capacity to adapt to the type of block that we have to get a more efficient codec. If you have a single model with a single parameter, you cannot adapt. If you have four models, you can adapt in a very efficient way. This is the BD rate compared with GPCC. And as you can see, for D1 and D2 metrics, these are two metrics, PSNR, two metrics for the geometry of point clouds, we have improvements of about 86% BD rate, a rate reduction of about 86%, which is very exciting because, you know, these DL-based point cloud codecs, they are very recent. Okay, this is deep learning for point cloud coding, very sexy topic, okay? But I want you never forget that, you know, you have to render the point clouds. The point clouds, if you want to see them in a 2D display, you have to render, and you can render the points, you can render the points with color, or you can bring the point clouds to a mesh and you do mesh rendering. Rendering is very important because at the end of the day, you have to do subjective testing. Okay, subjective quality assessment is very important in point cloud coding these days. We don't have good metrics, especially because what we see, it's a combination of geometry and texture. You have two things that go together. We don't have good objective quality metrics. Subjective assessment is very important. And you have here the original, the PCL coded, the VPCC and the GPCC. Quality assessment for point clouds, it's very important. Okay, I'm finishing. Almost in time, okay? So what is the message? So at the beginning, the question was light fields or point clouds. I hope I made clear to you that this is not, there is no winner. Both are useful, maybe in different conditions, sometimes together, okay? But you know, they are two sides of the same coin, they are twin brothers, you know, and depending on your needs, on your application domain, you may want to use one or the other, or even combine them. This type of planoptic representation is very powerful for immersive experiences, okay? Because it goes deep in the direction of this planoptic function that it's our dream, our benchmark. And there are a lot of coding solutions becoming available because coding and compression is essential to have experiences based on light fields and point clouds because the amount of data is basically huge. Okay, I hope you enjoyed. I want to thank a lot of people because I picked slides and pictures from a lot of people that helped me. Again, thanks to them. Thanks to you for being there. And now, if you have any questions, I will try to answer. Thank you very much. Obrigado a todos.
Thank you, Fernando. Very, very nice presentation. We have some questions. Only to say you have, we have five posters being presented in our event that are focusing on light field solutions, different light field solutions. But now we don't have works presented focusing on point clouds, but we have also some works in this team. Very, very, very interesting talk. We have here questions for Professor Gauthier. Thanks, Fernando, for this presentation and gorgeous slides. JPEG was in the past always concerned with static data only. In our, your presentation, you have shown a motion simulation approach in the point clouds. Could the JPEG cover proposals also consider these motion solutions? And then he also did another comment. I think that TISOC has been abandoned in the last MPEG meeting to be verified.
Well, I cannot see. I cannot see the answer. So from what you from what I understood from you, well, first of all, Gauthier, I hope you are okay. It's a pleasure to have you around. I hope I didn't say anything too wrong, because you are really an expert on these topics. You know, Gauthier is bringing an issue that it's not an easy issue. Some people believe that time is not a JPEG issue. And so JPEG would be static and MPEG would be with time. But you know, those that are more familiar with these things, they know that, for example, one of the most used codecs for digital cinema, it's called JPEG 2000. And I don't think that digital cinema is static, right? So it's true that in principle, most of the times, JPEG does not deal with motion estimation tools. But it does not mean that JPEG standards cannot be used to use to code dynamic content like digital cinema and JPEG 2000. So this distinction is very, very important to understand better, to go deeper, okay? I don't think that the point cloud calls for evidence that we have now speaks about motion or time. I think all the test material is static. So in that sense, the point cloud code is purely static, which does not mean, as I said, that you cannot pick a static point cloud codec and code a dynamic point cloud with a lot of random access, with a lot of error resilience, okay? So that's normal for me, okay? I'm not sure if I missed something, but I don't know what was the rest of the question. I think there is something that PreSoup was abandoned at the last MPEG meeting. Well, the last MPEG meeting was, by the way, last week, okay? So I'm not sure, but I am not surprised, you know? So you saw the results. So these deep learning codecs are very recent. I only know, well, at least two groups in the world, I group and the group of Frédéric Dufour, maybe there are others, I'm sorry. And it was amazing the gains that we could get for GPCC. So I have to agree that TreeSoup is not a very exciting tool, and I'm not surprised that they gave up on it. As you can imagine, this geometric representation in GPCC probably did not deserve in MPEG as much attention as VPCC, because VPCC is at the heart of MPEG with, you know, with AGVC, with the 2D maps. So I think that probably now, probably in the future, MPEG is giving more attention to GPCC, and I'm expecting improvements in this type of coding, maybe even with the deep learning based codecs. If I missed okay. something in the question, Luciano, tell me. I don't remember.
No, I believe that's okay. Carla also did a comment here. Fernando, your talks are always sensational. Congrats. Yeah.
Obrigado, Carla.
We agree.
Okay, obrigado. Vivo Rio.
Fernando loves Rio, loves Brazil, loves Carnival, and no, it's almost a Brazilian guy. we have other questions for the audience here. Ricardo Queiroz. And the question and answers. Why can't the Plenopt point cloud that you quickly mentioned be a common point for MPEG MIV, MPEG 3DG, and JPEG Plano? There are efficient coders for them, video or non-video based. Are the fields also
oh, Ricardo, Ricardo is a nasty boy, okay? Well, first of all, I don't know what is a common point. Point of what? Because JPEG Plano is a standard. MPEG 3DG is a group, or is a working group within SA29. And the MIV is a solution, you know, to code some type of information that it's true that can be used for point clouds and light fields. I don't know what Ricardo means by common point. I think where he's going, because he's speaking about failed walls and surmountable. So he's basically speaking about this fact that he knows I also don't like, that we have people doing basically trying to solve similar problems in different rooms. You know, one of the things that I learned recently is that, you know, I should dedicate myself to the technology and not so much to the politics. But Ricardo, one thing that you probably know is that in this reorganization of SC29, there is now a group, I think is advisory group 4, if I'm not wrong, that it's called JPEG and MPEG collaboration. And it is shared by Peter Shelkens. So I am expecting to see great things, you know? So at least now we have a group, we have a convener in charge precisely of stimulating the MPEG and JPEG collaboration. So this is a step forward. I didn't see anything happen until now, but it is too soon. So I hope that that something happens. I think that Gauthier, cannot speak. I don't know. But you know, the last time I spoke with Gauthier, we were very much sharing the same opinions about working together. I love working with Gauthier. We did things together. I would love to work with Gauthier again. Gauthier is in MPEG, so he's representing the MPEG side. I'm the JPEG side, but I don't have side. So I would love to do things together.
Okay. The next question. Do the learning-based point cloud compression techniques use ordinary CNNs or other convolution strategies, 3D, CNNs, graph-based CNNs, etc.? Pedro Garcia Freitas.
Well, as you know, our solution is quite simple. It's a very simple convolutional neural network with three layers at the encoder and three layers at the decoder. And we didn't use very sophisticated things, you know. It's not graph-based, it's not recursive, it's not GAN, it's not, you know, and we see this happening for images. So in a way, I'm looking very much to what is happening in the image coding domain. For example, in this JPEG AI call for evidence, and you also have the click workshop in CVPR, we see that for image coding, the very simple solutions like the one we used for point cloud is already evolving for more sophisticated architectures. So, you know, I have to be humble to believe that the same will happen for point clouds, okay? So the gains were huge for GPCC. By the way, let me tell you that the gains are not huge for VPCC. In fact, deep learning based codecs like the one I showed you is very much below VPCC. VPCC is very powerful, okay? Of course, you may lose something when you go from the 3D to the 2D domain, but VPCC, in this case, for static point clouds, it's very powerful, and we cannot beat VPCC intra. But Pedro, I believe that we will have an evolution on the architectures of the models that we will see for deep learning in point clouds, because the same is happening for images. And there is no reason why the same type of novelty should not come to point clouds.
Okay. The last question here is related to the first one from Queiroz. Thanks, Professor Fernando Pereira, for the presentation. What do you think it will we have a single MPEG codec for static dynamic and dynamically acquired point cloud in the future? It's Cristiano Flores dos Santos. this question?
Well, you know, in a way, you already have it, right? Because VPCC is a dynamic point cloud codec, but you can code a static point cloud with the VPCC intra. The issue is this VPCC type of codec, where you bring the 3D to the 2D domain. Okay, it has some weaknesses because of that. It's not, you know, point clouds are 3D, they are geometry. When you somehow project everything into 2D maps, you are somehow losing something. So I believe that we may have different point cloud codecs with different approaches depending addressing different needs. So you could use a single codec that could be VPCC with VPCC interpostatic and VPCC with time for dynamic. But maybe this is not enough. And maybe for certain type of applications, we want a real geometric representation, for example, to have interaction where the interactions are easier. And so maybe there is a good justification to have more than one type of point cloud codec, even for scalability, for example. It depends on your needs. And my opinion is that you may have more than one type of point cloud codec, one more like 2D maps and another one more geometry. It will not be GPCC. GPCC is too naive in a way, but it didn't get the investment that VPCC got. And I hope that we will have significant improvements, like the deep learning thing that I showed you. You know, we can reduce a lot the rate. So I think that a lot of things will be coming soon in these geometric coding approaches, probably using some kind of deep learning tools.
Learning is the main subject now. Do you think that you have some space for original algorithmic researchers in our area, or all of us will be only learning adjusters of parameters? And
well, you know, it's true that, you know, in a way is a it looks a black box because we don't understand it, but there is a lot of research in understanding, and a lot of people can already explain a lot of things about deep learning solutions. So in a way, in the past, when we had these handcraft algorithms, we were going to the simpler, to the complicated, because we were basically building this thing. In deep learning is a little bit like, I got the full thing already, very powerful, and now I am in the process of understanding what it is doing. But you know, probably you can even combine the two things. You know, there are, you know, for example, in my codec, deep learning based, we have an entropy coder that is a range encoder from old times. So, you know, it's just a new type of technology. It is coming, it will go back, it will go away one of these days. It's just the world evolving and the technology evolving, and that's great.
Okay, very nice. Okay, guys, thank you for your audience. Thank you, Fernando, again.
Thank you.
This was really a very, very nice talk, very, very interesting. And point you to the future of our area. We have a lot of challenges, issues related to the systems, but it's very nice to think about and to understand what the experts are doing to think in the future. Okay, thank you very much.
Let me just say one thing. Don't lose the presentation by Gauthier tomorrow. I'm sure it will be great.
Okay. the other talks are also very nice. You need to attend all the talks.
But you know, those that I know that also Vanessa Testoni is speaking. Yeah. So, you know, those I know, and they should be good.
Okay. Thank you, Fernando, again. The next section will start in 50 minutes. It's a poster session. Please, you are invited to attend the section and also to attend the question and answer section that will be done at the end of the day. Okay, and don't forget to vote for the best posters. And Fernando, thank you again. Thank you to support our school, and thank you for a very, very nice talk.
Thank you. Okay, bye-bye. Thank you. Bye-bye.